things just is soupy out there.
Yeah, so let's take a look and see what's doing. Obviously, the big story weather-wise is Hurricane Idalia. There's a look at the very latest statistics. Winds are up to 80 miles an hour. It is intensifying. That pressure is down to 977 millibars, lifting to the north at 14 miles per hour. And Jeremy, this is the storm that has all the tropical attention, not just across Florida or the southeast, but I think just in general.
Right. And one thing I want to note there is that's a pretty good forward speed, close to 15 miles per hour. That is not wasting any time there moving to the north. So maybe if it would keep that speed, we would not see as much intensification. If it slows down, then we might start to see the potential for rapid intensification. But I mean, either way, it's going to start strengthening. And there's just a few variables in play yet. But we have a hurricane out there.
Yep. So with that said, what does the forecast from the National Hurricane Center look like? Let's take a look. Okay. So over the next couple of days, it works gradually toward the state of Florida and gets stronger and gets stronger. And the official forecast from the National Hurricane Center brings it up to Category 3 intensity right at landfall, anywhere from about the Panhandle over to the Big Bend. And there is some uncertainty on its exact forecast path, Jeremy, and I think that it all has to do with the intensification factor.
Yeah, we'll see how strong it ends up getting. Right now, winds are at 80 miles per hour. Later today, forecast to ramp up even more, so potentially Category 2. I know we've been kind of debating this a little bit, looking at models. Some models are a little bit more to the west. I would say the National Hurricane Center track that you see there is probably east of what some of the recent model data is. It'll be interesting to see if they shift it or leave it on this little more curve off to the northeast into the Big Bend area.
Right. And to me, you know, the difficulty is that if you look at, and of course I don't have this loaded up, but if while I run my mouth, I'll show this. If you look at the intensity models, this is the biggest question mark, because the intensity models up to this point have just not shown significant intensification. They're bringing the storm up to Cat 2 intensity, and rapid intensifying storms and stronger storms act differently than weaker storms and slower to develop storms. And so if the forecast from the National Hurricane Center holds true, I would think that we would kind of hug the right side of the cone just a little bit, because as it deepens, it's going to want to get picked up more and curving with the Coriolis force. We saw that in Ian last year. We've seen that, you know, countless other times. So I think that that's why, Jeremy, even though the forecast model envelope is set, and I think this is the reason why the Hurricane Center is kind of keeping the forecast just a little right or a little further east than the forecast model envelope.
Yeah, and we see that often, especially in hurricanes with rapid intensification. Models might not quite grasp that, so the Hurricane Center may be leaning towards that happening, and of course then curving a little bit more to the right, as you were mentioning. So you're showing that right there, kind of the latest model tracks, spaghetti plots, pretty consistent.
But you know what's interesting is just in the as we're talking about this, we've just gotten the new suite of models, and they have shifted just a little bit. They've shifted a little east. This morning, I was showing this exact graphic on the air, and everything was on the left side of this forecast cone, and now we've kind of settled into the middle. So that is a subtle shift east, but it is a shift to the east. And you know, I think that that's notable. What I'm curious is, will the Hurricane Center then shift their cone a little to the east as well? You know, we're really nitpicking at this point, and I'm not at all saying anything bad about the Hurricane Center, because all this is it's a game of odds and trying to you know, hedge your bets. But the storm seemingly this morning kind of hung a little east of their initial forecast motion. So I think that this, you know, this kind of hanging on the right side of the cone may be something to look out for come the 11 o'clock advisory.
Right. And I know you showed this map earlier on social media. Could you bring up the radar and also the track from the National Hurricane Center? And you noted, at least earlier on, that that center circulation was just a little maybe to the right of the forecast path.
Yeah, so what we're looking at there, just so that you understand what you're seeing here. So essentially, you've got the one with the red line. That's the forecast from the hurricane center and you see that dot, essentially the eye or the center of circulation on radar, it's close. I mean, I'm not saying that it's way off, but it was a little further east, and from the 5 a.m. to 8 a.m. advisory, they had to nudge it a little further east than initially thought. So, you know, there's a lot. And you know, we say this a lot, especially when it comes to the 11th hour. Jeremy, when it comes to landfalling systems, wobbles are to be expected, and wobbles in this phase can impact greatly 24 hours from now, come landfall. A wobble now can change the whole dynamic of things.
Yeah, and I've been really stressing here, if you get a shift of 50 to 100 miles in Southeast Georgia or the low country with the track of this, it has not significant, but it has a pretty big change in the impacts you may be seeing across the area. So I think changes for my area would be, right now it looks like there's an increased tornado threat before the center of circulation would get here, because now it's maybe a hair slower. So we have time to heat up a little bit tomorrow with feeder bands starting to move in. So maybe morning, midday, early afternoon, our tornado threat is up a bit. SPC did highlight that today. Slower system would then pair up a storm surge or onshore flow potentially with our high tide during the evening. So our tide forecast has gone up just a little bit, not anywhere close to Irma or Matthew stage right now. So that's good news, but it is maybe a little more moderate coastal flooding, bordering on major, not too far away from that. So we'll watch that. And I do think my entire area will be under a tropical storm warning here pretty soon.
Oh, I would definitely think so. Now, in terms of impacts, in terms of threats, right? We need to eyeball those. So let's start off by just kind of dialing up the wind threats, and we'll start in Central Florida because that's obviously the closer threats. We'll start with flooding threat. Okay, so for today, flooding is a big threat, particularly where the center of circulation would make landfall. The possibility of flooding is certainly there in my western areas, and then out east. We're watching that. For you and your area, Jeremy, it's just kind of a watch and see kind of thing, not a big threat for flooding.
Right. So we are thinking today, these are just some scattered showers and thunderstorms. It's more like tomorrow that our flood threat would ramp up here. A lot of street flooding possibility. And then I did mention some coastal flooding that's more tide driven. For our area, we've been going kind of 2 to 5 inches of rain. There might be some totals that surpass that.
Right.
We'll see how that plays out. But I think flood threat, at least for us, would be more kind of like if you get just an absolute deluge of a summertime thunderstorm and it has 3-4 inches of rain in it. Low-lying areas, especially streets that are prone to flooding, probably see that again.
Right. Okay, so when it comes to the wind threat, in purple, that's the major hurricane force winds, the big bend up into the panhandle, certainly. Excuse me. For my western areas, Marion County, western Sumter County, we're looking at strong tropical storm force, 60 to 70 miles per hour. And then across the metro off to the east, 40, 50, 60 mile per hour winds, which are still potentially damaging. And then looking further up the shoreline, kind of getting into your area just a little bit, I'll flatten this view just so we can get more cities to pop up. But, you know, with that said, you know, you're looking at, for you, the Hurricane Center's calling for 60, 70 mile per hour wind gusts, certainly inside the realm of possibility.
Yeah, last night on air, I went 55 to 70 mile per hour wind gusts for around I-95 towards the coastline. I think if there is any slight shift to the west, what it would do is it would just enhance tropical storm force winds across the entire area and maybe even push some of those higher gusts a little farther inland. But notice that little speck that you see there near, I believe, is that Buford up there?
Yep, it's up near Buford, yep.
Yep, so Buford to Charleston. This is potentially showing wind gusts there, maybe 70 miles per hour or higher.
Right. And so, you know, when you start talking about that, obviously the concern is going to be damaging winds in addition to just the feeder bands and any kind of onshore wind on the lead up to the storm system itself.
Right. So one thing I want to mention here, and we were talking about this sort of offline, but if you have the new IBM or Graph model coming in, it drops the pressure to 925 millibars in the far northeast Gulf.
Yep.
Again, that's a forecast, doesn't mean it's reality, However, a couple days ago, it had Franklin down to 925 millibars, and I believe it did get down there.
It did. Yep.
Yeah, so that model did very well with Franklin. We'll see how well it does here with the Dahlia. But right now, the newest IBM model coming out, and this is the one that's been a lot closer to the Euro and the National Hurricane Center forecast track, does have it down to sub 930 low.
I mean, that would be I was doing some research, and if that comes ashore in that spot, Jeremy, and Florida's governor said it, and it kind of threw some of the news folks in my newsroom here off, because it's a stat you don't hear. The last storm that made landfall in the Big Bend at any kind of a hurricane strength would be 1968, Gladys. But if you go further north, like where that future cast model is showing, you're talking about two hurricanes in the 1800s. So places like Cedar Key, they have in more than a generation, I mean, you're talking more than 100 years since they have seen a hurricane hit like what this has the potential to do. Very, very swampy area. Obviously, you know, tree limbs can come down in any thunderstorm, but they have not seen anything like this in such a very long time.
Yeah, and if people aren't accustomed to it, you tell people how to prepare, but it's easier to prepare for something you've been through before or have experience with. So a lot of people have never seen that unless they've lived in other areas potentially.
Right. So that's the future cast model, and obviously it's making landfall in the Big Bend from there. It's not run far enough out where we can take it to your area just yet, Jeremy, but the GFS is, this is the 6Z run of the GFS, intensifying to, you know, major hurricane. This one's a little further west. I'll be interested to see what the 12Z GFS shows, but that would bring, you know, plenty of wind to you. And then here's the 6Z European, which is the latest European model that is out, and it's kind of it's a little east maybe of the GFS, but still west of most of the other models. But just looking at this, the new future cast model has nudged a little to the right. I've noticed that the latest computer forecast tracks from the Hurricane Center have also nudged a little to the right. So it'll be interesting to see if that's the beginning of a trend.
Right. And we're talking about these moving west or east. And so far, one thing for forecasters that's been pretty good, we haven't seen significant wild swings, windshield wiper effects like you often allude to. These have been subtle shifts, and obviously our precision to detail impacts letting people know sensible weather conditions. We're really laser focused on little shifts here or there, but in the grand scheme of things, the track overall hasn't moved a lot.
No, and the computer models the entire time have seemingly been tightly packed. I mean, as a whole, they've been shifting, but it's not, you know, some storms, you get this unbelievably wide array, and you're like, it could be in Florida or Louisiana, right? In this case, they have really done a great job, and as we've been flying recon missions, we've been getting better and better data. But all in all, I would say that the confidence in this has been pretty good.
I think so. And as you were mentioning, you said that the kind of those spaghetti plots that you had up earlier have shifted a little bit, but I don't think the Hurricane Center's track has really been moving around a whole lot.
No.
So I think they're taking the kind of the consistent approach until there's a little bigger swing one way or another. And it seems like if there's been a shift east and then back west, it's kind of come back to their forecast.
Yeah, 100%. I want to dial in real fast and just look at the latest recon mission. This is live statistics coming in from the NOAA P3 Orion that's flying out right now. And we've noticed winds, you know, getting well into Category 1 hurricane intensity on their last core punch. They're kind of heading back into the storm system to see what's doing right now. And of course, as they do that, we'll be able to get better information. But Jeremy, the storm definitely is deepening. There's a new Air Force reconnaissance flight that's taking off, it looks like, from I don't know where that is, but it's taking from the United States Virgin Islands, from St. Croix, of course.
Okay.
A new mission is taking off and flying out. But, you know, so we're going to have plenty of recon data coming in. But at the moment, it looks like the pressure continues to drop down.
Yeah. And just for in kind of everyday terms, lower pressure can then translate to higher winds. So storm is strengthening.
Right. And I'm just kind of looking. The last eye punch that they had, the pressure was at 978 millibars, okay? So 978 millibars. The last official output was 977. So it does not look like, at least at the moment, that it's rapidly intensifying. Okay. But that makes sense because it hasn't even cleared out that eye yet. So that's, I mean, that's good. But with constant recon data, you know, we're at least going to be able to, in somewhat real time, have an idea. We know just by being able to look at the live radar out of Key West, I mean, it's trying to do that. But because of the curvature of the Earth, we're also at like 20,000 feet when we're scanning this thing at this point.
Right. Another thing in looking at some of those high resolution models that we keep referencing, that IBM or the graph model, is that that doesn't peak the intensity until the storm has moved north of north of the Tampa area.
Yep.
That's when it really starts to show it getting stronger.
And I mean, if we want to nerd out for just a minute, okay, and you and I put out a long range forecast, we have noticed every single cycle of this, the majority of the energy was always in the northern Gulf. So that would line up to that, knowing atmospherically that the overall weather pattern supports the northern Gulf for that energy. So that's all lining up, but that also lines up to keep it fairly potent through your area.
Yeah, and people keep asking, we'll get to a lot of questions here, but I've noticed at least on my end, people keep asking about impacts from my area. So I think the worst of our impacts will be probably after 3 p.m. on Wednesday and before 11 p.m. So in that corridor is the time frame of worst impacts here. And we were already talking about, you were showing the map. I think we could have maybe 60, 70 mile per hour wind gusts in some spots, but it's more than likely a lot of wind gusts here that are probably going to peak 50, maybe 60 miles per hour.
Right, right.
But the wild card is, how strong is it at landfall? So that's something we don't know yet. So that's why there's still a little bit of uncertainty. We don't have any hurricane watches in my area right now. We just have tropical storm warnings and tropical storm watches.
Right, right. And that'll get there. You know, it all works off of that, you know, T-minus 48 hours from impact, T-minus 36 hours from impact. So, you know, once you get within 48 hours, you should get those watches, which I would imagine would go up pretty shortly. Whereas for us in Central Florida, we are under hurricane warnings in our westernmost areas and the rest of Central Florida under tropical storm warnings, because those conditions are likely. Live look at the mesoscale channel of the satellite imagery, and this is such a high resolution look. We get a new frame on this every minute, and at this point we still don't have an eye trying to clear. We're definitely seeing convection bubbling, but we haven't cleared out an eye just yet.
Okay. And that's a visible satellite, so that's just like taking a picture up in the sky. Do you have right now the watches warnings from Florida through the southeast, even if you start your area and then move north? I think that will give people kind of a good idea of what they are under right now.
Right. So here's a look, and this is just kind of, this is my area, right? So in red, those are hurricane warnings. That means that hurricane conditions are expected duration-wise within the next 36 hours time. That in red. So western Marion County, western Sumter County, and then all along the west coast. And that does include the Tampa area. That does include Pinellas County, the St. Petersburg area. And that goes all the way up through the Big Bend and all the way up through Apalachicola. Tallahassee under a tropical storm warning, but they're further inland and the expectation is the worst of the weather would stay east. Now for you, you're under tropical storm watches, but no warnings at this point.
Yeah, Savannah has a watch. Now you see that kind of that turquoise color there. Our southern tier counties, you get near the Altamaha River and point south down in that area, there are tropical storm warnings. So I've just been telling everyone, I don't care if you're under a watch or warning right now. We know the impacts are coming. They're likely going to be tropical storm force for our area. So that's what you need to prepare for in my area.
100%. And then when we look at the models, and again, this is just kind of the latest model consensus. And as I mentioned to you, Jeremy, just a few moments ago, like it does look like they've curved to the right just a little bit. But, you know, there's kind of this 800-pound gorilla in the room, which is that right-hand side stuff. And you know, I can't show this without at least, I feel like, addressing it and having a somewhat of a conversation about it.
And I just say, please don't do that.
Yeah.
I mean,
at this point, we just don't know. It's comical,
right?
and it's going to be lighting social media on fire. But we have to understand, we don't even know what it's for sure going to be making landfall as. And so the computer models are trying to chew on, you know, step 45. We're on step 3 right now.
Right. And it may be a situation where it gets to, like, coastal Carolinas. It slows down, maybe stalls a little bit, and then starts moving again.
Right.
So, I mean, the computer models, you start from the starting block and you start going. And once you're one lap around the track, so to speak, and say you're running a mile and you're going 4, once those models are around once, they kind of start to lose a little bit of their punch, might have some errors involved, those compound down the road. And before you know it, that fourth time around the track, you're walking and really struggling. So that's kind of what we're looking at there with those spaghetti plots is not much uncertainty probably after day 3 or 4.
Right. And this is where it's a good reminder that there's a reason that a meteorologist has a place in the world. Now, you know, AI is going to do AI's thing, but like, there's a reason that you've got somebody working through a forecast and putting it into perspective. And by the way, we thank you for hanging with us for that. One other thing, Jeremy, that I wanted to discuss is the fact that, you know, we're talking about local impacts for us, but just outside of either of our coverage area, certainly, is the Tampa Bay area. And I wanted to mention them just because looking at storm surge concerns, even if Idalia stays well off the shoreline, because of the angle of attack and because of the spin, the circulation, we could be talking about some significant storm surge flooding going into Tampa Bay.
Yeah, why don't you break that down? I know you're very familiar with that, not too far away
sure.
from your viewing area. And that is do they have storm surge warnings there now?
There's all kinds of storm surge advisories there, and for just cause, because if you figure the winds are going to be kind of coming in from the southwest as the storm system approaches us, and that's going to force water into Tampa Bay. And so it's going to pile up the water up along MacDill and Old Tampa, Ybor City. And the problem is that in this area, you know, Bayshore Boulevard there floods on a king tide, you know? So if you're pouring up water, piling and piling and piling, and according to the kind of the latest projections, the Hurricane Center is saying you could get a 6-foot rise in water. Jeremy, I saw an image from kind of like a weather chaser, and it was of the convention center. And what they had done, and I hate to laugh at this, but what they had done is they had taken, it looks like a tarp, put it over the door, taped it to try and seal it, and put sandbags at the bottom. It's like, now the convention center is like right on the water. And I remember it was like there was a tropical storm, I want to say it was like 12 years ago. It was when the Republican National Convention was at the convention center there, or the arena, and there was a tropical storm coming in, and there was like massive flooding. I don't remember the exact, I think it was Irene like 12 years ago, something like that. Maybe even yesterday, now that I'm thinking. But either way, this is an area very prone to flooding. So even if this stays off the shoreline, I'm concerned about a significant storm surge threat through Pinellas and Hillsborough counties there.
And that's mainly at some point, what, later today or tonight?
It's going to be, yeah, this afternoon into tonight, and we'll watch. I've got live storm surge gauges, but at this point there's nothing, you know, wicked happening there.
So that's a good transition there with your storm surge. We have storm surge watches in my area with a storm surge of potentially 2 to 4 feet. Now, the key is, does that hit during high tide, low tide? If it's a low tide, when that high water comes in with any type of surge, it's usually not an issue. Dorian was about 65 to 60 miles off our coast a few years ago when that hurricane went by. That was a strong storm.
Right.
We did not see really any coastal flooding at all with that because the storm surge came in during low tide. I've seen simulations from the National Weather Service that if that would have hit during high tide, Tybee Island, one of our barrier islands here east of Savannah, would have been, for the most part, inundated with water over a large part of that island. So it's all about timing with these tropical systems.
Right.
Obviously, for the tides, not good timing. Just in general, they're already at or above average with the full moon phase here, and a super moon at that. So our high tide we'll watch is coming up on Wednesday evening.
Right. And then, in addition to all this, like, it's tropical systems are just such multifaceted events. There's also the threat for tornadoes being on that right front side for both of our communities. So here you go, kind of Orlando and the I-4 corridor north and west. We're looking at the threat for several isolated tornadoes. And then that threat, Jeremy, goes right up into your area as well.
Yeah, we do have slight risk of severe weather tomorrow. And if you have handy by chance, yep, how far out do you have the graph model?
Oh, the new run?
Yeah, because if you go out to around 15 to 18 Z, if you happen to have like a reflectivity thing up, that would really be able to highlight the tornado potential, because we have what looks like very intense storms with some of these feeder bands starting to rotate in mid-Wednesday morning through maybe early afternoon. And yeah, I'm just looking at that and already thinking, okay, we're going to be doing some tornado coverage potentially.
Yeah, right there. You're getting it with the WESH banner. I can't manipulate
that's all
right. it. I can't manipulate it.
That's right.
Yeah, all right. So there's that. Yeah, so there.
In that timeline tomorrow. So yeah, if you back it up a little bit, go to like probably like 9 a.m. through about 2 p.m.
Yeah.
And those storms that are rotating in, watch that as Eric cycles through that. There's some pretty intense storms, and those would be the ones with the tornado potential, not around or very close to that eye.
Right. Well, and just the same, you know, for my area, you know, you see there's that first wave this afternoon and evening right there that we'll have to watch for some spin. And then as the storm comes in, notice those outer bands just kind of getting thrown around, particularly in my western areas. But there's no telling, like right there, you see that, like 6 a.m. tomorrow. Yeah, it's going to be that kind of stuff right in there. 6 a.m., 7 a.m., 8 a.m., right as it's making landfall, those are going to be the windows of energy that we'll really have to watch for spin in my area. But I think that tornado threat is going to definitely be a thing for both your and my communities.
So that's the new IBM that you're showing, right?
That was, yes.
Because it does, I'm looking at it here on my computer, and compared to other models, it kind of, once it makes landfall, starts to make a little more of a hop to the right.
Interesting. Yeah. I'm really curious to see what's going to happen. And to that point, you know, it's 10:28. So we're about as far in as we're going to get, you know, and it looks like it's kind of started wobbling. That center of circulation has kind of started wobbling back off to the west just a little bit. So, you know, it's not a major shift to the right, which is good, but you know, this is something, it's going to be like wobble watch, you know, we're going to have to watch this through the day, because any wobble that holds could change things down the line.
And also I saw a discussion about sometimes you get these stronger hurricanes or any hurricane that forms, and then you get eye replacement cycles. I don't know if this one would have time. I think
no,
we would probably get a stronger storm, and then it's going to be the landfall by tomorrow morning.
I think what we're doing right now is its attempt at a replacement. It's just trying to form one, and it's been trying to form one for the better part of 12 hours at this point. So that's why we haven't seen explosive development. So I consider what it's doing now kind of a replacement cycle. It's just trying to formulate it. It's taking its sweet time because of this subtle shear coming in from the southwest. But as that shear drops off, I think once it starts that rapid intensification cycle, if that happens, which we think it should, that's when it's going to get going. So at this point, let's take some questions, Jeremy, that way just before we have to go running.
Okay. All right. Let me hop up here. I'll tell you what, if you have some, go ahead. Yeah. I already took some asking about my viewing area, and then we can trade off a little bit.
Sure. So Samantha's asking, is it possible that Idalia will come back and hit the East Coast? At this point, you know, we have to see how strong it is at landfall in the Big Bend. And then after that, we have to see, does it go back out over water, or does it hang out over Jeremy's community? And then after that, we'll be able to look down the line and see about a loop around. Certainly the models are kind of hinting at it, but remember, computer models are guidance, not gospel. So we have to take it, process it meteorologically, and then from there we can kind of come up with a forecast. And that's why it's important not to trust a computer model, but to take a computer model, get some interjection from somebody who understands, a meteorologist or sort, and then kind of take it and go from there, Jeremy.
Right. I just had a question here about storm surge and people very concerned in some of the low-lying and coastal areas of my viewing area. And I don't think my thoughts have really changed on that a whole lot. It's the second high tide on Wednesday that if we would see any type of flooding that's above and beyond what we normally have during kind of higher than normal tides, that's when it would occur if a storm surge is paired up with that. But it's really about the final track of the storm, because if the storm starts going closer to the coast and then it's past us by that high tide, the winds would be northwest. So that it's pushing the water away. But if it's slower, you're piling it up ahead of that high tide. So
Right.
that's when you can start to get the issues where you're adding storm surge to already higher than average tides.
Right, and that's never good. Taylor's asking about Southwest Florida impacts, and I'm seeing a lot of people asking about that. I understand that Southwest Florida was just battered by Ian last year, and I'm so happy to say this does not look like it's going to be a direct hit on Southwest Florida. But with an onshore wind, it is going to push up a little bit of water. We're not expecting a major storm surge, just some added surf, that sort of thing. You may get a feeder band or so, but thankfully this is not going to be that kind of a big hit like what we saw with Ian.
Yeah, and understandably so. I think people there, it's going to take an awfully long time to not get nervous about tropical systems down there. So happy to see that this storm most likely will be missing them with most of their impacts. So asking about tornadoes once again, people are getting a little more concerned about that in my area. Will the tornadoes be strong? Typically with tropical systems, not always. These are quicker spin-up tornadoes, maybe even get a waterspout that moves over some of our islands or beaches. But I would say a good kind of test of what we've seen here recently when we had Elsa move through just a couple of years ago, we did have some tornadoes with that. I believe it was an EF1. So they were usually like EF0, EF1. Not that that is a good thing. But strong tornadoes, obviously, last year in 2022, in my viewing area, we had the strongest tornado anywhere in the United States. So you don't think about areas close to the Southeast Coast with a tornado like that, but it was a high-end EF4. So is it that type of setup? No, but certainly, even if you get an EF0, 1, 2, you can have winds 80, 100 miles per hour with that, and definitely cause some damage. So we will be updating everyone if there's tornado warnings, and Eric would be doing the same down in his area.
And frankly, we're kind of planning on, we're kind of, Kellyanne and I are, we're leading the coverage in the morning. We're kind of planning on tomorrow morning being busy time, for sure. Tina's asking, what are the chances it turns into Tampa area and comes up I-4? At this point in time, that's not the forecast. None of the models are indicating that. But it's all deterministic on rapid intensification today and any kind of wobbles that may take. So that's one of the reasons we're watching literally frame by frame of the radar versus the forecast path, just to see how it all plays out, because a little wobble can do a big shift down the line.
Yeah, so I'm kind of glancing through questions here. Okay, so you talked a lot about kind of like tornado threat in your area, coastal impacts. So I have a couple questions here. Someone that lives well inland in my area, probably at least 50 miles or so around that west of Savannah, and they or have concerns about living in a trailer. So I would just say, hey, if there's a tornado warning, you need to be able to get that alert, whether it's TV on your device. That's why we always stress to people, there will be some sporadic power outages. Make sure and charge your devices tonight and as long as you can into tomorrow morning. So if there are changes where there's warnings across our area, you're able to get that information. Both WESH and WJCL 22, when we're on continuously, we're always streaming our coverage. So even if you lose power and you have it on your phone, you can just open up our apps and watch us live on there. So areas well inland, if you live in a trailer, you'll be probably seeing some tropical storm force winds. For a trailer, obviously, the tornado potential there for damage is a little greater.
100%. 100%. So, looking ahead to Thursday, a lot of people here big UCF fans, myself included, this should not impact the UCF football game at all, I'm happy to say. But, it just depends on exactly where this goes and if law enforcement is needed to go help out elsewhere. So it's a little too early to 100% say, but, for now, we're just kind of watching all the other impacts. So any other things on your end, Jeremy? Otherwise, I've got to go run and be on TV here in a couple minutes.
No. I think we're good, and I can answer any questions people had here that we haven't gotten to once we're off.
All right, very good. We'll continue to track the trial. I don't know, Jeremy, that I'm going to be able to do anything tomorrow morning. I have a feeling I'm going to be a little busy. So right. if you want to do something, I can give you the keys to the castle, and you can broadcast on both of our pages.
I think what we can do also, what we normally do, is you'll be doing some Facebook Lives updates for your viewers here at WJCL 22. Jonathan did one specific to our area this morning, so our weather teams will each kind of be breaking out and doing that, and certainly maybe we have a recap on this, but otherwise every Tuesday, this isn't just some new thing we're doing.
Oh yeah,
all hurricane season long, Eric and I, Tuesdays 10 a.m. we give you the tropical update. For a while it was just us chatting, looking long range stuff, wasn't a whole lot going on, and then here we are in that busy part of the pattern that we've been talking about for months now, late August into September. So even when it quiets down, we'll be here to guide you through the rest of hurricane season.
And we'll be posting everything on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, and Amazon Music, although it may take me a little bit to get these up there. Just busy doing our thing. So, all right, listen, thank you everybody for joining us and trusting us on Tracking the Tropics. From currently looking pretty nice Orlando, Florida, I'm WESH 2 meteorologist Eric Burris.
And in Savannah, Georgia, from WJCL 22, I'm Chief Meteorologist Jeremy Nelson.